On today's episode, flow batteries versus lithium ion. What's best for grid scale storage? Today's episode is brought to you by engineering.com, a globally trusted source for engineering content. Check out this and many other exclusive videos for the engineering professional found only on engineering.com TV today. When it comes to grid-scale alternate energy generation, solar, photovoltaics, and wind turbines are always in the media spotlight. But these sources are intermittent, and even when applied at scale, it's common for fossil fuel generating plants to stand ready to provide fill-in power when needed. Grid-scale battery storage is the obvious solution to the intermittency problem, and several companies, including Tesla, build systems that are being deployed worldwide, including the US. For electrical utilities, there's a double benefit: reduction of reliance on fossil fuels and the ability to retire existing peaker plants or expand service without the expensive permitting and environmental review processes necessary to build power plants today. For major power utility customers, however, there's another economic incentive to use large-scale storage: security. Recent wide-scale weather-related blackouts in California and Texas are expected by climate scientists and power systems engineers to occur with increasing frequency, and many industrial processes are very intolerant of power interruption. One customer that is highly dependent on reliable power is the U.S. Army, and Lockheed Martin has been awarded a contract to build the first megawatt-scale long-duration energy storage system for the U.S. Department of Defense. The company will install its GridStar Flow vanadium redox flow battery technology at the U.S. Army installation at Fort Carson, Colorado. It'll be under the management of the U.S. Army Engineer Research and Development Center's Construction Engineering Research Laboratory. The project is designed to test the performance of the Lockheed Martin system as a storage and distribution technology for renewable energy sources, although it could also be used as a backup power source to conventional power generation. This first unit is expected to provide up to 10 hours of power for essential base needs in the event of service interruption. Now, commercial grid-scale batteries have been deployed worldwide using multiple technologies, from older lead-acid and nickel-cadmium types to sodium salt and lithium-ion cells as used in electric vehicles. Vanadium reflux flow batteries, however, use a different chemistry, and in a significant difference, the charge carriers are circulated in a liquid from tanks using pumps to flow electrolytes past an ion-selective membrane. Compared to lithium-ion technologies developed for automotive use, flow batteries are large, heavy, require moving parts such as pumps, and have a poor energy-to-volume ratio compared to other battery types. For ground-based energy storage applications, however, weight and volume are rarely a consideration, and the technology has several advantages. There are no limits to energy capacity. The aqueous electrolytes are non-flammable, and systems can have a long life, 15 to 20,000 charge-discharge cycles. But most importantly, flow batteries promise low cost when used in large-scale systems. Vanadium redox flow batteries are one of several grid-scale storage technologies in active development and deployment around the world. Now, Lockheed Martin, a provider of weapons systems and services to the Pentagon and U.S. allies for a century, has 6 decades of experience in power generation and storage for military applications. But the GridStar flow system is branded by the company as a commercial product. Will Lockheed Martin emerge as a major player in large-scale battery storage? Commercial sales are a radically different proposition compared to military procurement, but the fact that the largest defense contractor in the world is targeting vanadium redox flow technology at both military and civilian markets suggests that the age of the gas or coal-fired peaker plant may be over. Well, that's it for today's episode of This Week in Engineering, brought to you by engineering.com. For our deeper engineering series, visit engineering.com TV for exclusive shows like Manufacturing the Future and Designing the Future, not found on our YouTube channel. The links are in the description below. Thanks for watching.